How many waiting? Participants have joined. Okay, 6 have joined.
They have joined already. So gradually it started, you know, they keep joining in between. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so very much for joining us for this wonderful session today. I am Shankar from the T-Hub team, and it's my pleasure to welcome the speaker for today's webinar, Dr. Tasneem Sharif. And she, just a quick intro about Tasneem is, she is a member of the Institute of Company Secretary, ICSI, and also a gold medalist from the Nagarjuna University of Law. She also holds an IPR from National Law School, Bangalore, and has done VPO IPR from Geneva. She also holds a certified course on startup growth and finance from University of London. And she was also awarded, an extraordinary contribution to startup and women empowerment. She was honored with prestigious Nelson Mandela Gold Medal at a very young age. So welcome, Tasneem. Look forward for the session today. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Shankar. Are we waiting for some more time for a few participants to join?
Yeah, we can wait a couple of minutes, at max couple of minutes, and then probably start.
Okay. Any queries on corporate compliances, you can post in the Q&As. We will take up the Q&A session in the last 15 minutes. We will wait for 1 or 2 minutes, then we'll start.
Sure.
I can start my screen.
Yes, please.
Okay, good evening, all the participants, entrepreneurs, directors, a very warm welcome. So I'm Dr. Tasneem Sharif. So before starting the session, on a lighter note, I wanted to ask, what do you call a priest that becomes a lawyer? Does anyone has the answer? I know you can't speak. I'll repeat the question. What do you call a priest that becomes a lawyer?
Participants, you can just use a raise hand option to talk to the speaker directly, or else, of course, you can drop your questions or answers in the chat box.
Okay. Did you guys get the question? What do you call a priest that becomes a lawyer? Okay, so the answer is, it's father-in-law. Okay, so starting about statutory compliances, it's such a tedious law. I mean, even if you ask the highest powered person in India, the Prime Minister or President or Rajnikanth or Amitabh Bachchan, if you ask them how many laws are there in India, how many legislations are there in India, they will not be in a position to explain you, give you a number at once. there are more than 1,000 laws, acts, and on a daily basis, so many notifications, rules, regulations are being implemented, released on a daily basis. So it is truly next to impossible to tell how many laws are applicable to a company, to a corporate world, to an individual. On a general basis, for a company, there are more than 6,000 compliances to be taken care of. So I will not take you through all the 6,000 compliances. I will be touching only the mandatory compliances and few event-based compliances, which as a director, as a company, everyone should be alert. So the basic foundation for an idea to be implemented, you need a vehicle. You need a business entity to run the show. So the business entity can be in the form of LLP. It can be in the form of one person company, private company, partnership firm, or a sole proprietorship. So generally, 95% of the startups or entrepreneurs opt for private company. So we will be focusing more on private company compliances. So private company compliances under the Companies Act 2013, you will be amazed to know that under the section, under the Companies Act 2013, we have more than 470 sections and more than some 12 rules and regulations. Then there are few chapters, 7 chapters, and a bunch of notification circulars. So what exactly is a private company? So these are the 4 criteria which differentiate a company as a private company. So what is the minimum capital required for a private company? Can anyone reply on that? I'm sure you all might be running a private company. So what is the minimum capital required for a private company? Okay, Ravi is telling 1 lakh and all others are also telling 1 lakh. Exactly correct, but you are also wrong partially, because with effect from Companies Amendment Act 2015, the minimum limit of 1 lakh has been removed. And now you will be surprised to know that you can incorporate a private company with zero capital. Yes, with zero capital. Okay, capital as low as 0, as low as 10,000 can also start a private company. Okay, so coming to shareholders, how many shareholders minimum should be there to start a private company? Can I have the answers, please? Yes, exactly. Two shareholders. And what is the maximum number? Okay, so Ravi says 20. Unlimited. Jay says unlimited. Okay. No. Shareholders in a private company. Yes, Ranjit, you are right. It is 200. So maximum shareholders can be 200. Minimum is 2. Maximum is 200. Okay. So coming to transfer of shares, this is one of the essential crux of the private company. The equity shares of a private company cannot be easily transferred, unlike in public companies. Okay, so every transfer of share has to be taken with the prior approval of board of directors. And it generally happens in closed circle. Okay, so what is the minimum number of directors in a private company? I'm sure this is an easy one. No reply. Okay, the minimum number of directors in a private company is 2, right? And what is the maximum number of directors in a private company? Anyone? Okay, Ravi, it is not 20, it is 15. So the maximum number of directors is 15. If you are a director in a private company or public company, the maximum number of directorships you can hold in various companies is limited to 20. Okay, in a private company, the number of directors is limited to 15, whereas you can extend your directorships for 20 companies. Hope that's clear. Okay. So what are the compliances provided under the company law? These may be broadly divided under two categories. One is mandatory compliances and the other is event-based compliances. Mandatory compliances are those compliances which a company has to comply, whether it is having zero turnover, no employees, no activity, anything. Kuch bhi ho jaye, I mean, directors are ill, anything, it has to be complied. And event-based compliances are those compliances which happening of an event. I'll explain you further on this. So coming to few mandatory compliances which a company has to comply irrespective of what may come. So the first compliance is first board meeting. So every company, as soon as it is incorporated, it has to hold its first board meeting within 30 days from the date of incorporation. So a notice for board meeting has to be sent to every director at least 7 days before the board meeting. So generally 7 days is prescribed in the Companies Act. The company can very well reduce further. It can say 5 days, 2 days, 1 day as per the articles of association. Where there is an emergency and you need to call a board meeting immediately in next 1 hour or by evening, you can hold the board meeting with the consent of all the board of directors. Okay, so coming to the subsequent board meetings, okay, that was with respect to first board meeting. What about the subsequent board meeting? So every company is bound to have minimum 4 board meetings in a year, and the gap between one board meeting and the other board meeting should not be more than 120 days. That means you have a board meeting every quarter and make sure the gap between one quarter and the other quarter is not more than 120 days. In case of small company, it is sufficient to conduct only 2 board meetings. So what exactly is small company? Small company, as per the Companies Act, is a company which has a turnover of paid up capital of 2 crores. It is termed as small company. So the third mandatory compliance is issuing of share certificates. I'm sure many of the private companies miss on this. They incorporate the company, but they fail to issue the certificates. The share certificates under the common seal of the company should be issued to the shareholders within 60 days from the incorporation. And it should be signed by 2 directors. And if company secretary is there, it has to be signed by the company secretary as well. Okay, coming to fourth mandatory compliances. This is a very, very general compliances, but I'm sure everyone will miss on this. So every company shall have painted or affixed its name, address, registered office at the outside premises of its business. I mean, outside premises, you should have a board which displays your name and registered office. So wherever you are carrying, this is really, really very, very mandatory. And there are companies which have been charged with penalty for not complying with this provision. Coming to the letterhead of the company, this is also a very important provision. Every company should have a letterhead with the name of the company mentioned. And wherever name of the company is mentioned, SIN should follow along with the name. So make sure wherever you are using the company name as a letterhead, you should have the SIN along with this. And when you are advertising there also, you are using the company name in newspaper, you should display the SIN number as well. Okay, the letterhead should have the telephone number, email ID, business. And this should be continuously carried across every letterhead, and including all other official publications. Okay, coming to filing of disclosures. disclosure of interest by directors. This is really a very simple compliances, but every director misses on this. So there has been so many notices issued by the company law ROC for non-compliance of this. So what exactly is this is, in every year, in the first meeting, suppose my year starts in April. So if I'm holding a board meeting in April or May, in that first board meeting of the financial year, I should take a declaration from the directors. The company should take declaration from the directors in respective forms DIR 8 and MPP 1. What does this DIR 8 and MPP 1 disclose? They disclose the interest of director in various other companies and his shareholding in such companies. So this has to be mandatorily given to the company in the prescribed format. And suppose during the year, I being a director, I exit from some company or I join some other company, I need to give a refreshed DIR 8 MBP 1 to the company that this is the change taken place from so and so date. So the board has to be informed well in advance. And this has to be recorded in the minutes that the company has received disclosure of interest from the directors. Okay, going to the next, resident director. So I'm sure you all are aware that the director in a private company should be a resident director. Even though if you are having a foreign director, one of the director should be mandatorily an Indian director. So a resident director is defined in Income Tax Act, which says his presence should be there in India for 182 days. Otherwise, you will be attracting RBI FEMA regulations. So coming to alteration in MOA and AOA, every alteration in articles and memorandum shall be filed with the register of companies within 30 days. So whenever there is a resolution passed for enhancement of authorized capital, for change in articles or issue of preferential allotment or issue of debentures, any such item resolution should be passed in the general body meeting, and a form called MGT 14 should be filed with ROC within 30 days. So this also talks about the resolution, copy of every resolution. So there is a format for the resolution also. Section 117 describes that. So there should be an explanatory statement. What is the agenda item? Everything has to be explained in the explanatory statement in detail. So the format has to be strictly followed, and you cannot miss on that. And in case if you are missing to file MGT 14 in 30 days, so if you're filing on the 31st day, additional penalty will be attracted for this. Not only MGT 14, every form additional penalties will be attracted. So coming to the registers, this is also very, very mandatory, and every company is bound to follow this. So these are the few registers which the company has to maintain. Either physically the registers have to be maintained, or if it is a startup, or if I suggest if it is a startup and not much activity, you find soft copy of the register. So that also you can feed and save it in the laptop. That also is equal to compliance under this section. So generally big companies, what they do, they have huge registers for all this. They have 6 to 7 registers, or a combined register will be available. So all these have to be updated as and when an activity takes place on a yearly basis, and auditor has to audit this, that all the entries have been duly recorded, and he has to mention in the audit report. So each register, if it is non-compliant, attracts different penalties, imprisonment. So please make sure sure you comply with these registers as well. It's a very simple compliance, but you need to comply with it. Okay, coming to the minutes of the meeting. So this is minutes. This is the binding effect. I mean, to tell that company is running. If you record something which is wrong in the minutes, and in future any dispute happens between the directors, the court will obviously rely on the minutes. So whatever you record in the minutes, it should be a conclusive evidence that it is genuine and it has been circulated to all the directors. There are so secretarial standards which are issued by Institute of Company Secretaries, which is also very mandatory to be complied. So minutes of the meeting, it looks very, very simple, but it is the conclusive evidence that the meeting has taken place and the board have approved this. These directors have dissented, assented, everything has to be recorded. You will be surprised to know that the start time of the meeting, the quorum, the end time of the meeting, everything has to be recorded. And within how many days it has to be signed by the directors is also to be complied with. Coming to the next point, appointment of director. So earlier, before Companies Act 2013, even though if a director don't have DIN, director identification number, DIN is like a PAN number, which every director will have. So mandatorily, the director should have DIN number. So if director is not having DIN number, and if he is appointed as a director, that director will be prosecuted and penalties will be applicable on him. So mandatorily, when a director is appointed, you have to take his consent in DIR-2. There's a prescribed format in DIR-2, and such consent should be filed with ROC within 30 days from the appointment, and the form prescribed is DIR-12. So when all these forms, formats keep changing, you have to keep a track on what is happening on the MCA, ROC, and the formats, the forms keeps updated every now and then. So coming to the next mandatory compliance, it is provisions related to DIN. So as I said, every individual intending to be appointed as a director shall make an electronic application in DIN form should be in DIR-3. So form DIR-3 is used for filing DIN. So qualification of a director. So the declaration from director at the time of appointment should be taken in DIR-8, and also annual disclosures should be taken in DIR-8 with respect to the details of directors, his qualifications, his interest in various other companies, his shareholding in other companies and all. Number of directorship. So as I explained you earlier, no person shall be appointed as a director in more than 20 companies, which includes the number of public companies, 10. So if I'm a director in 20 private companies, then that's fine. I cannot go beyond 20. And this 20 should be inclusive of 10 public companies. Okay, hope that's clear. Coming to the next mandatory compliances, suppose a resignation by director. Okay, so if a director, there might be a peculiar situation where there is a rift among the directors and one director want to quit. So but the company is not accepting his resignation. So what will the director do now? Suppose A and B are directors and A want to discontinue as director. So, but B is not ready to accept the resignation. What is the situation of A now? Is he still liable for all the manipulation taking place in the company? Will he be liable? Okay, so this kind of peculiar situations happen. So what the director who want to quit, what he can do, because the management is not accepting his resignation, he can very well file a form which is DIR-11, which is available on the MCA site. He can file from his end to ROC and inform the ROC that I'm exiting from the company, but the company is not filing my exit. So that is equivalent to compliance from your end. So whatever there is delay from the company in filing resignation, it is penalty will be paid by the company and you will be deemed free from all the obligations from the date of your resignation. I hope that's clear. So resignation by director. Director shall intimate his resignation to the company and the company should file ROC 3 in DIR 12. So this DIR 12 has to be filed in 30 days. Even for appointment, you are filing DIR 12. Even for resignation, you are filing DIR 12. But whereas in the case of auditor, it is not so. For appointment, you will be filing ADT-1 and for resignation, you will be filing ADT-3. So there are so many forms. Unless you are accustomed to these forms, formats and all, it's not an easy cakewalk. Okay, so coming to next mandatory compliance, it is meeting at shorter notice. So as I said, generally a board meeting has to have 7 days mandatory notice as per the Companies Act, whereas articles of association can either reduce it further, and where the act also says that where all the directors consent that yes, we can have a shorter notice provided 95% of the members entitled to vote had approved the shorter notice. Okay. So coming to quorum, quorum shall be 1/3 or 2 directors, whichever is higher. Quorum means the persons present in the meeting to make sure the meeting can run, the board meeting can run. So directors, so what is the status of directors who are participating through video conference? So as per the Companies Act, directors attending through video conference will also be counted in quorum, provided all the video conference is recorded for future reference. Okay. Coming to the next mandatory compliance, first auditor. So as I told you, as soon as the company is incorporated, within 30 days, a board meeting has to be held. So there are few 10 to 12 points which has to be ensured that it is taken place in the board meeting. So one of the point is first auditor. The first auditor should be appointed within 30 days of incorporation. Even the first board meeting should be held within 30 days of incorporation. Okay, so on appointment, ADT-1 has to be generally filed for auditor appointment. Okay, but in case of first auditor, ADT-1 is not mandatory at all. So this first auditor will hold office from the date of incorporation till the date of first AGM. So the company will have power to change the auditor in its first AGM. I hope that's clear. Okay, coming to subsequent auditor, as I said, the board shall appoint, the board can either continue with the same first auditor after the first AGM or appoint a different auditor. On appointment of a different auditor or continuing the same auditor, the company has to file ADT-1. And make sure that generally in Companies Act, the forms have to be filed in within 30 days. But there are few exceptions where you have to file within 15 days. And one exception is filing of ADT-1. So ADT-1 form is to be filed within 15 days from the date of appointment. So generally, date of appointment means the date of AGM where a subsequent auditor is appointed. So ADT-3 is a form, as I told you earlier, for appointment or resignation of a director, the form used is DIR, whereas for appointment of an auditor, the form used is ADT-1, and for resignation, the form used is ADT-3. So ADT-3 also has to be filed by the auditor within 30 days from the date of his resignation. So AGM, every company is required to hold annual general meeting on or before 30th September during business hours. Please look at this. I mean, within 6 months from the close of financial year, that is 30th September, every company should hold a annual general meeting, and it should be within the business hours on a day that is not public holiday. So it has to be between 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. and it should not be a public holiday, and it should be at the registered office or at a place, city, town, village where the registered office is situated. Okay, so coming to the next mandatory compliance, filing of financial statements. So as soon as AGM happens, generally the AGM is annual general body meeting is held for approval of financial statements. So after approving the financial statements, the company has to file within 30 days balance sheet with the ROC. This is called as form AOC-4. Then also a different annual return has to be filed, which discloses about the shareholding pattern of the company, which is called as MGT-7. And this form has to be filed within 60 days from the date of AGM. So whenever the turnover increases up to 50 crores or more, you have more compliances to comply with. So a practicing company secretary MGT-8 form also has to be attached. So coming to regularization of additional director. Okay, so it can happen that in the mid of the year, you will be appointing few directors. So suppose X is appointed as a director in the month of June. So any director being appointed should be appointed as an additional director. So you are taking all those disclosures, DIR-8, MGT and all, everything is taken, and an additional director will be holding position as a director from the date of his appointment to AGM. So on the date of AGM, it is mandatory on the part of the company to either end his tenure or reappoint him, regularize him as an ordinary director. So for this regularization, the company is required to file DIR-12 with the ROC with change in designation within 30 days from the date of AGM. Okay, coming to the director's report, this is very complicated report. I mean, there is a prescribed format, separate rules, what all has to be disclosed in the director's report, what figures have to be mentioned, everything is there, which has to be perfectly followed. And this director's report should... Okay. So it should be signed, and also the signing of the director's report, it should be done by two directors or a chairperson of the board. So coming to the filing of financial statements of a foreign company. So Lavanya is writing, it is really a complex topic. Okay, I'm trying to simplify the best, Lavanya. This is more complex if we get into the sections and regulations and subsections. Okay, so let's not touch on foreign company because I'm sure no, you guys don't have any foreign shareholders. If so, if you need any assistance, I can guide you on that. Because whenever your holding is more than 51%, which is held by a foreigner, the guidelines of RBI FEMA gets attracted. And that's again a different compliance story. Okay, then coming to this, that's the end of mandatory compliances. And please don't think that these are only the 10 or 12 mandatory compliances. If I tick mark everything, I'm safe. Every now and then, ROC, MCA keeps issuing notifications, which keeps adding new mandatory compliances. Okay, coming to event-based compliances. So these are generally triggered on happening of certain events. There is paperwork that needs to be done on happening of every task or event. In case of non-compliance, or even if you miss a deadline, huge penalties, additional fee or compounding can be attracted. So hence it is necessary that happening of an event, all the compliances are taken care of. Okay, so what exactly are event-based compliances? So if we talk about event-based appointment of a director, increase in authorized capital, allotment of securities, change in registered office, creation of charge, name change of the company, agreements, resolution, auditor change, KYC. These are only a few basic important event-based. There are so many event-based. Rights issue, preferential issue, private placement, debenture issue. Okay, so these are the forms to be filed. This is the timeline. I'm not explaining more on this. So we'll go to the next slide. So remember, cost of non-compliance is always more than compliances. So generally for filing a form for a startup is hardly 300 or 600. But when you miss the deadline, when you fail to file within the mandatory date, the non-compliances fee keeps adding on a daily basis. You will be surprised to know that few sections have penalty of almost 100 rupees per day, 500 rupees per day. Okay, so going to the next, mandatory forms. Okay, just to summarize all the mandatory forms, as on date, I had made it in a chart, which are already explained you in the previous slides. So if you can see balance sheet, I'm sure you're aware, director appointment, resolution, auditor appointment, KYC. KYC is one mandatory form which has been added from the past 2 years. And also DPT3 is one form which has been added from the past 2 years. Similarly, MSME dues. So these are the mandatory forms which a company has to file on an yearly basis. Okay, so if you're a director, you cannot miss on these three sections. So what exactly these three sections talk? Okay, suppose I am a director in a company. I'm also a director in five other companies. Okay. So I can't keep my eyes shut and say that all the companies are complying. I'm only a sleeping director. I'm not an active director, executive director. Suppose my fifth company is not complying with all the, has not filed the balance sheet, the annual return for a period of 3 years. Okay, suppose my fifth company has not filed the balance sheet, annual return, or defaulted in payment of deposit, repayment of deposits or preference shareholders or debentures, this 164-2A gets attracted. So how is it affecting the director? Okay, so that fifth company, because of the mistake of the fifth company, my directorship is in danger. So because it did not file for 3 years, all the company directors stand disqualified under section 164-2A. So if you are a director, please make sure all the companies, wherever you are directors, are filing up to date. So you will be disqualified from the fifth company, fourth company, and all the companies wherever you are director. And also you cannot be appointed as a director in new companies for a period of 5 years. So disqualification continues for 5 years. So coming to section 248.1, what exactly is this section? So as I told you, the fifth company, which is not complying, which is not filing its annual return balance sheet for the past 3 years, ROC has the power to strike off the companies. I'm sure you are aware that in the past 2-3 years, ROC has struck down more than 2 lakhs companies across India, which are not filing anything from the past 3-4 years. Okay, similarly, ROC has sent disqualification notices under section 164 to more than 3 lakh directors. So just think, 2 lakh companies, 3 lakh directors, all have been struck down, disqualified. Okay, so what? So coming to the third section, which is also a very burning section, section 203. This is key managerial person. If you're an executive director, you are a CFO, you are a company secretary, CEO, or any other described person, you will be attracted to this section. So any default happening in the company misses any due date, the company is missing on any filing, the CEO, CFO, executive director, company secretary cannot say that I am not the person who was looking after it. You cannot escape the liability. You will be termed as the key managerial person. Okay, these three sections are really very tough to comply. Okay, Manish is asking any compliances for change of address. Change of address, Manish, if the change of address, I think you meant to registered office address, right? If the change of address for registered office is within the same city, town, just a simple form has to be filed. And if it is from one state to other, the process is very complex. You have to file a petition and it will almost take 45 days. Okay, Ravi, I'll answer your call. Let me finish. Hardly four more slides are there. So this was about statutory compliances in Companies Act. So coming to statutory compliances under labor laws. So there are more than 25 plus labor laws which are to be complied, taken care. I'm just enlightening you on the important labor laws which we have to ensure we comply. So Contract Labor Act 1970. So these all acts are more than 50, 60 years old. Okay, if the organization is having 20 plus more employees and all the employees are on contract basis, Contract Act applies. So Minimum Wages Act, it differs from state to state and ensures that minimum wages are paid to the workmen. Okay, then coming to Payment of Wages Act, Payment of Wages Act, the employer has to ensure that the salary is paid on or before 7th of every month. And Equal Remuneration Act, and this act ensures that a man or a woman who are doing the same work, having the same experience, qualification, the salary cannot be differentiated. This act, the Equal Remuneration Act, protect men and women from unfair salaries being paid. Okay, coming to the Provident Fund Act, I'm sure everyone is following this. So if your basic plus DA, dearness allowance, is less than 15,000 per month, this act gets attracted. But many employers voluntarily, even though your salary is less than 15,000, they apply across all the employees. So what exactly is, if your organization has 20 or more employees, this act is attracted, Provident Fund Act, and this governs Provident Fund and pension during retirement. So 12% deduction of basic plus DA is done. Employer will deduct 12% plus 1%. So employer will deduct 12% plus 1%. In that, 8.33% will go towards pension scheme. If employer is giving in the form of cost to company, the employer deduction will be added to the cost to company. Coming to Employee State Insurance Act, so this is applicable when 10 or 20 more people are employed. So monthly wage does not exceed 21,000. So this gives a medical insurance for individual plus family and accidental insurance for individual. So a deduction of 0.75% of wages. If you can watch carefully, the word used here is wages and not basic plus DA. So if my salary is 30,000, so 0.05% on the 30,000 will be deducted, and employer will contribute 3.25% of the wage. So total 4% of the wages is contributed to ESI Act. Okay, so coming to the Bonus Act, this applies to factories and establishments and where there are 20 or more workmen. So statutory bonus is actually very mandatory for all the companies, and the minimum rate to be paid is 8.33%. So the maximum limit, there is no bar on the maximum limit, but the minimum has to be paid. This is annual payment. Gratuity Act. Okay, so employing 10 or more workmen. So Gratuity Act is applicable when you have a continuous period service with a single employer for 5 years. So what will you be getting on completion of 5 years? You will be paid 15 days on 15 days of salary on the last drawn salary for the number of term period you had worked with the employer. Suppose you worked for 10 years. So 15 into 10 years is 150 days. So 150 days of your last salary drawn will be calculated. So professional tax, this is also a tax, and the maximum bar on this is 2,500 per annum. So I'm sure everyone will be having this 200 or 200 deduction in their salary slip. So coming to Telangana Shops and Establishment Act. So Shops and Establishment Act is a state act where it governs the leaves, holidays for each employer. So these are the 12, every company should have 12 sick days, sick leave days, and 12 casual leave days. And public holidays are generally declared by the government, so you need not worry on that. And earned leave, you have 15 days. And earned leave will come when you complete 240 days of continuous service. So it keeps getting added on a pro rata basis. And the working hours as per the Telangana Shops and Establishments is 8 hours on a daily basis and 48 hours on a weekly basis. Okay, so Industrial Dispute Act governs relationship between employer and employee. So this Maternity Benefit Act, so generally a minimum 26 week paid leave should be given to female employees. So approximately 26 weeks comes to almost 6 months. Earlier it was 3 months. Then in last previous 2 years back, it was enhanced to 26 weeks. So the limit is for 2 kids. You can't continue to have kids and say, I need maternity leave. Okay. Okay, that's it. So I would be happy to take the questions.
Dear attendees, you can always use the raise hand option. Yes, Lavanya, please go ahead and talk. You can unmute yourself to talk.
Hi, guys. Good afternoon.
Hi, Lavanya.
Thank you for conducting this session, first and foremost. It was very important.
Thank you.
I'd like to understand something in here. Let's say somebody has already defaulted on their PF and ESI. Without their knowledge, as in they were not sure about how to conduct it. Okay. Is there a possibility for these guys to know how long they have defaulted and how to correct that problem? Because I keep getting in a lot of these requirements from the logistics companies, the small, very small ones, they are into warehousing and all that. Mm-hmm. And they come back to me with they only have like about 2 or 3 employees sometimes, as small as that. So even if they want to grow, they don't know what to do to undo the mistake that they have done without causing in a lot of penalty or, you know. So okay. How do we help them? How do we kind of guide them into this?
Okay, Lavanya, first thing, the moment the PF and ESI is deducted by the employer, it is the duty of the employer to remit the amount to the department. Okay, so if the employer is defaulting and not remitting to the department, the employer will be held responsible, he will be prosecuted, and it can enhance to the level of imprisonment also. His personal property also can be attached for getting the money back. You can directly write to customer care of that department, Provident Fund or ESI. You can mail to them. They respond on to the mails.
Yeah, there was one particular case where this guy has actually handed over the amount to an HR consultant, and that guy is not to be found anywhere now. So they came to me asking in for suggestion. Can I guide them to you?
Yeah, no problem.
Cool.
Thanks. So that's my address. I'm basically service partner for T-Hub as well.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Lavanya. Okay, so Ravi is asking, how can I change the first auditor? So Ravi, as I told you, before having your first annual general body meeting, decide on the new director, take his approval, take his consent, and pass a resolution in the first annual general body meeting. You also have to take NOC from the first director. There are forms to be filed, ADT1, ADT3, which has to be taken care. Are these forms available online as well? Lavanya, all these forms are available on MCA website, but unless you have knowledge of these forms, you cannot tell which form is for what purpose. Okay, any other queries?
Yeah, Jay, go ahead with your question, please.
Hi, Tasneem. Thank you very much for this session. And Tasneem, I've been working with one of the company. I mean to say, I know this person through my known contact. However, the company is now into making some small losses where they want to have someone investor to get involved. So could you just let me know what would be the process? I mean to say whether the investor would be adding as a director and he'll be a stakeholder in the company. What is the process for that?
It is purely based on the shareholder agreement and the deal, how you carry with the investor. Suppose Jay, the investor is bringing a huge amount and he also wants shareholding and directorship. You have to, first of all, have a shareholder agreement in place, describing all these points clearly in SHA. And if he is insisting on directorship, you have to appoint him as an additional director first and regularize in the subsequent annual general body meeting. Then in case if he wants shareholding, you can either transfer shareholding shares from your existing shareholders, or you can increase your authorized capital, issue preferential allotment to the new investor.
Mm-hmm.
Is that clear?
Yeah, thank you, Tasneem. It's clear. I can reach you offline, right, if I need anything.
Yeah, sure, anytime.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jen.
Tasneem, there is a question from Mr. Manish. Any compliance for change of address?
Yeah, I already answered during the PPT. So if Manish is talking about change of registered office within the city, if he is shifting from T-Hub to some other Gachipoli, it is just a simple form to be filed. Approval of board meeting is required. Okay, suppose it is from one state, from Hyderabad to Gujarat, from one state to another, the process is very lengthy. It will take almost 45 days to 2 months, and you have to file a petition with NCLT.
Go ahead with the question, please.
Hi, Tasneem. So this is a very useful session. You know, just wondering what stage of a company you know usually you get involved in. Is it startups or maybe you know mid-size or large?
So you mean my advisory company?
Yes.
So I am an expert in startup. So I am associated with GitHub from inception. I am also advising many big companies like Greenco, GVK, Nagarjuna. So the portfolio is from small to big. It covers everything. I'm sorry, I didn't get your name.
Yeah, my name is Vinay, actually. I just used my short form. Okay.
There's no bar on the small or big.
Okay. And is this advisory comprising also of the CA services or is it primarily on the legal side?
No, it comprises of secretarial, legal and accounting, taxation. It's a bunch of everything, funding and all.
Sure. I'll reach you on your number. Okay.
Yeah, sure. Anytime. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Vinay.
Thank you, Vinay.
Jay, you have another question to go? I see your raising option.
No, I'm sorry. Got clicked by mistake.
That's absolutely fine. Thank you so much. If at all you have any other questions, you can of course put the question in the chat box, or you can connect the stream offline. The details are there on the screen. If you don't have any questions, we can you want to share something else. So we have still 5 minutes with us, or else we can call for the day.
So I mean, these statutory compliances looks very easy, appealing, and you think that I can do on my own. Why should I pay so and so amount to the auditor or company secretary or advocate? I can Google, take the data, and comply with it. But it's not so easy. Suppose if it's a matter of changing an auditor. So the Act, Companies Act, is not straightforward. So if you search change of auditor, it will not give you one section. You have to link the respective section with the rules, regulation, what form, where is it available, in how many days it has to be filed, whether any notifications are there, whether any changes are there. Everything has to be linked. And as a professional, you have to keep updated on a daily basis, which as an entrepreneur, as a startup, is a bit tedious to take care of this. You might be aware that there are more than 6,000 compliances for a company when it gets established. See, when as a new company, you will not be receiving notices from the ROC immediately, but ROC has the power to go back up to 10 years, 12 years, open the records, open the forms which you had filed, and it can question you. It can also question you, where is your register? Where are your minutes? Why are the minutes not following the secretarial standards prescribed by the Institute of Company Secretaries? So from minutes drafting, from recording the time when the meeting started, when it ended, how many assented, how many dissented, every minute thing has to be taken care of, and every minute non-compliance attracts different kinds of penalties, different imprisonments. That's it. I want to say that's my number. The first number is my WhatsApp number as well. So any queries, I would be happy to help.
Yeah. Thank you, Tasneem. That was truly a wonderful, wonderful session, and I very much understand. This 1 hour session is not sufficient to cover all these issues, but we will see.
Cover taxes at all? That's again a ocean.
I totally understand that. But we'll try to see if at all we are able to do any such sessions with Tasleem in near future. We'll let you know. And thank you to all the attendees for joining us today. It's a pleasure to have you all. And there will be a feedback form that will appear on your screen as soon as we end the session now. So please do share your honest feedback. It will help us to improve. And thank you so much, Tasneem. It was truly an insightful session. We'll try to do many more because, you know, I totally think I was there complete 1 hour, and I totally think this 1 hour won't be suffice for this kind of, you know, subject or this kind of domain. So we'll definitely look forward to have so much of many other sessions in the future. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.